Thank you. Well, thank you, and good morning. And for those of you not from Virginia, welcome to the Mother of Presidents, the Cradle of Democracy, the Commonwealth of Virginia. It is a remarkably great day for our Commonwealth, and personally inspiring to me for a couple reasons. One is I get to be the warm-up act for Amy Grant and Vince Gill. What a treat for me. I've admired their music for a long time. But secondly is I grew up just about a mile down the road. Still have a house in the family for 50 years that my parents owned. My mom worked here for 18 years for the great director Jim Reese. I spent a lot of time as a kid on these premises learning about the great indispensable man, George Washington. My mom and dad served on the board here at Mount Vernon, thanks to Governor Allen appointing them many years ago. And so this is a remarkable and special place, not only for my family, but I think for all 8.2 million people in Virginia, that we celebrate today, 214 years late, the opening of the Center for the Study of George Washington. This is a man that was extraordinary in the life of our country. And I want to say to the ladies who have maintained the life and legacy and been the lover and custodian of the great things about our first president now for 160 years, thank you for everything that you've done. And so to Ann Bookout and all the vice regents, God bless you for a tremendous 16 decades of taking care of George Washington. And now you've got some help. I want to thank Kurt Wiebrandt and, of course, Jim Reese and all those who have had this privilege of being the executive director of Mount Vernon and working with the ladies and everything they've done to continue to make Mount Vernon the most visited spot in all of Virginia. Over a million people walk these hallowed grounds and learn about the great man. I think about the words of Edmund Randolph, the first Attorney General of the United States, the third Attorney General of Virginia. And in that eulogy of George Washington, he perhaps said it best, that this was a man that was first in war, first in peace, and first in the hearts of his countrymen. I think that's why you're all here today. Truly, this inspiring man, while one of eight Virginia presidents, perhaps was the indispensable man, and as you said, that is responsible not only for the victory and the American Revolution, but for those initial tough years in the fledgling democracy to bring a ragtag band of colonists into the great knowledge of self-government and self-rule. It is great, Fred, that you and your team from the foundation have been this amazingly generous $38 million of the foundational gift for this facility. It's the only library in the country for a president that doesn't take one dime of government money. And I can tell you, with state and federal budgets, that's a big deal today. And I want to thank the private sector and all of those of you who displayed such amazing generosity to make this facility happen. Washington was an extraordinary man for reasons that are well known. He was a surveyor, a businessman, a farmer, a property manager, a great general, a tremendous leader, a congressman, a member of the House of Burgesses, President of the United States for two terms, and one of the best whiskey makers in America when he died. That's quite a life in a short period of time. But more than that, he's a remarkable leader. This is a man after the American Revolution that was able to quell a potential coup of the army by merely taking out a pair of spectacles and putting them on and said, "My eyes have grown tired and I am growing blind because of the service to my country." And at that, a potential insurrection was averted. This was a man who perhaps preserved the Union by getting down on his knees in 1777 and 1778 at Valley Forge. And though he was the leader of the army, he realized that he had to submit both himself and the goals of the American Revolution to divine providence, to God. And in prayer, this nation was born, and I believe in prayer this nation will be preserved. It's the picture that I have behind my desk at the office and behind my desk at my house to remind me that this was truly a nation that was born because of divine providence. The words of Jefferson immortalized that concept. Washington said that it was impossible to govern without God and the Bible. And so throughout his life, he was a man of quiet faith and a man of immense humility. Senator Kane reflected that at the mere tender age of 16, he wrote some 100-plus lessons about civility. My, what a great country we would be, or even a better country we would be today, if all adhered to those lessons of civility that Washington learned at 16. He also wrote a great book on lessons of leadership. And in that, he talked about faithfulness and humility, a tenet and a character trait that he exemplified throughout all of his jobs as president and as a political leader. The indispensable quality that Jim Collins still said in the book Good to Great today is the true landmark and the two distinguishing fact and trait between great leaders and good leaders. And in his first inaugural address, he said something I believe that is still worthy of repeating because it defines who we are as an American people. It are words that I knew that he believed should be continue to be repeated and reflected on throughout the ages. He said, "The propitious smiles of heaven can never be expected on a nation that disregards the eternal truths of order and right, which heaven itself has ordained." Washington understood there were timeless values that the Revolution was fought for, and to the degree that America maintained its fidelity to those principles, we would be a great nation, and to the degree we departed from them, we would be a lesser nation. He was a man that loved veterans, and I know in Virginia we have 837,000, just about more than any other state. We have an amazing two-century relationship with the United States military that we love and embrace here in the state that's home of the Pentagon. Washington knew that if we did not take care of veterans, we would not be able to have the great men and women come into the service of the country that preserve the liberties that we enjoy today. John Warner, 17 years old, decided to serve in that United States Navy. But Washington said that the willingness with which young people are likely to fight in any war, no matter how justified, shall be directly proportional as to how they perceive that the veterans of earlier wars are treated and appreciated by their nation. We take care of veterans today, we get great men and women to come into the service of the country to fight the battles of tomorrow that will surely come. He understood that. And to the degree that we continue to understand that, we'll have an outstanding United States military to defend the liberties that you and I enjoy and love today. So I'm honored to be here, and on behalf of all the 8.2 million people of Virginia, this is a spectacular day. 214 years after Washington's death, this remarkable facility now will serve as a place where scholars, political leaders can come from all over the country, from all over the world, to study and learn at the footsteps of perhaps the most consequential man ever to walk in Virginia or America. I tell people all the time, if you want to understand America, you need to understand Virginia. If you want to understand Virginia, you need to understand George Washington, because he truly was the man that gave life and voice and breath to this republic in its most challenging times. So thank you for coming. Thank you, Ann and Fred and everybody that had a hand in making this possible. And from this day forward, the legacy and the vision of George Washington will grow ever brighter. God bless you. Thank you.